Scientists are working on a full bodysuit, which, depending on how you're feeling, might either warm or cool you down. Alternatively, artificial skin suits could also respond to touch, temperature, and moisture completely on its own. Or cyborg hands controlled directly by motors interfacing with our brain and nervous system that can adapt in response to external inputs such as people touching you, the wind or rain. Welcome to the futuristic era of intelligent matter, a novel artificial intelligence computer concept which is to be put directly into the fabric of synthetic matter for you to wear. Welcome to this episode of AI News. In this episode, I will show you how these Iron Man-like suits will look like, what they will be able to do and what technology is being used to create these synthetic and smart nanosuits. The main materials which are, and will be used to make these suits, are being powered by brain-based computing, and may eventually lead to soft robot skins or assemble microswarms of drug delivery nanobots into your body, all while conserving power as they learn and adapt, so that there's no need for them to be charged by an external power source as the body alone already produces enough energy to power those so-called nanobots. Consider a warm blanket. Rather of being powered by a single controller, it will have computer circuits strewn throughout. This computing network may then use neuromorphic computing, which is a brain-like process. This technological fairy dust then changes a mundane blanket into one that learns your preferred temperature and time of day in order to anticipate your preferences when a new season approaches. Oh, and if it's constructed of nano-sized building blocks, it could be able to rearrange its internal structure to store your information in a built-in memory. To put it another way, Iron Man's endgame nanosuit. We're on our way to get to the point where we're able to get our own. We've done a fairly decent job using resources we either invented or collected, from rockets that might carry us to Mars to a basic cotton t-shirt. But they're just that, passive stuff. Nature, on the other hand, is abundant with intelligent matter. Take, for example, human skin. It's waterproof, allows just certain molecules in, and shields us from pressure, friction, and the majority of germs and viruses. It can also mend itself after a scratch or rip, and it can sense the temperature outside and cool us down when it becomes too hot. While our skin does not think, in the conventional sense, it may send data to the brain in a flash. Then it's time for the magic to happen. With over 100 billion neurons, the brain's circuitry can execute massively parallel calculations while requiring just around 20 watts, similar to a laptop. Why can't human-made materials accomplish the same thing? Because of energy costs and temporal delays, our present computing design fails to enable brain-like computation. This is where neuromorphic computing comes in. It's a concept that exploits the brain's capacity to process data in parallel while using very little energy. To get there, scientists are completely rethinking computer processors. In contrast to today's chips, which separate processing and memory units, these chips process and store information in the same area. It may appear strange, yet this is how our brains learn and store new knowledge. This configuration eliminates the need for cables between memory and compute units, effectively teleporting data instead of transmitting it down a congested cable. Massively parallel processing at a low energy cost is the ultimate result. Living creatures, in particular, may be thought of as out-of-the-box computer systems. These objectives and brain-inspired neuromorphic hardware goals are particularly well-suited to programmable and highly linked networks. Neurons and synapses, the connectors that link individual neurons into networks, power the brain. They used a range of materials to create artificial brain components that are linked into networks. Famous examples are Google's Tensor Processing Unit and IBM's TrueNet. They combine compute and memory in one device, making them particularly useful for executing AI algorithms. However, according to the scientists, the next step is to disperse these small brains throughout a material while also adding sensors and actuators, thus creating a circuit that mimics the whole human nervous system. We may need to use other technology to respond rapidly to the situation. One suggestion is to make advantage of light. Chips based on optical neural networks can calculate at light speed. Another option is to create materials with neural networks that listen and learn, that can reflect on their own judgments. Add to that matter that can alter its physical form based on input which, for example, from water to ice, and then we might have a library of intelligent matter that could revolutionize a variety of sectors, including autonomous nanobots and lifelike prostheses. The next topic is responsiveness. This has the ability to change its makeup in reaction to its surroundings. These materials may alter their form, color, or stiffness to conceal from predators, similar to how an octopus changes its skin color to hide from predators. A 3D-printed sunflower with sensors that blooms or shuts in response to heat, force, and light is one example. Another is soft materials that can stretch and plug into biological systems, such as a silicon artificial muscle that can stretch and lift over 13 pounds repeatedly after being heated. While it is a clever trick, it is incapable of adapting and can only follow its predetermined path. Adaptive materials are found higher on the intelligence food chain. These have an integrated network that processes data, temporarily stores it, and adjusts behavior based on that data. Micro swarms of tiny robots that move in a coordinated manner, akin to schools of fish or birds, are one example. However, because their conduct is pre-programmed as well, they are unable to learn from or recall their surroundings. Finally, there is intellectual content that can be memorized and learned. It all starts with four elements. The first is a sensor, which collects data from the outside environment as well as the material's interior condition. Imagine a temperature sensor on your skin. The next component is an actuator, which is essentially something that modifies the material's properties. As the temperature rises, for example, your skin will sweat more. The third is a long-term memory unit that may keep information as knowledge for the future. And then, finally, a network which is made of Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, or whatever which then links each component together, much like nerves in our brains. Scientists, and especially the hardware processor giant, Intel, are currently looking to make all of that a reality in many fields. Even fields that I haven't mentioned in this video are going to be able to benefit from this new type of technology. Although when it will happen is debatable. Although just recently, Intel did manage to create a neuromorphic processor with about as many neurons as a lobster, which is pretty impressive and might be considered the first step.
So neuromorphic systems will solve problems that involve interacting with real-world data in time. So speech and video, robotics where you're moving things through space in time and responding to external events, especially where there's unexpected adaptation that's required. I think in terms of more near-term applications, what you'll see in 4-5 year timeframe, you'll start to see neuromorphic chips in smart factories where we have robotic deployments today. So we may be able to apply neuromorphic intelligence to make these robots assemble a little more smarter. So that's really the inspiration, is to figure that out and to find what are the principles, what are the ideas that nature has developed over a billion years of evolving brains, and taking that and putting that in chips.
So what is your opinion on people potentially being able to buy their own Iron Man suits in the near future once the materials and compute units become cheap and good enough? What about the possibility that only rich and powerful people are going to be able to buy such empowering items for themselves, while poor people are left in the dust? Please tell us your opinion in the comment section below. I would love to hear what you have to say about it. Thank you for watching AI News. We consistently report on the newest technologies that are shaping the future of our world. We'd appreciate you subscribing and watching our other videos. See you around and take care.